My name is Waleto Gebre. I have lived in Harar for the last 10 years. Ever since I was a little girl, my dream was to become a famous movie actress. I never miss any film being premiered in the city. I look at the actresses on the billboards and think that it could be me. But what I really do is sell khat in the Makonnen Square in Harar. I go to the market every morning and I sell about 10 kilos of khat daily. I usually finish selling my merchandise before noon and then I head home. Once a month, I travel by train to Djibouti to sell large quantities there.
Waleto lives with her husband and several nieces and nephews. She doesn't have any children of her own. Her husband is a police officer and earns about $100 a month. Waleto brings home twice as much money as her husband by selling khat here and in Djibouti. One could say that they are a middle-class Harari family. Ethiopia is a Christian island surrounded by a sea of Muslim countries. Harar is an island within this island, a Muslim city buried deep in the heart of Ethiopian Christianity. But first and foremost, Harar is a difficult city to classify. It is the fourth holy city of Islam and houses almost 100 mosques within its walls, the largest concentration per square kilometer in the world. Alongside the numerous mosques, however, there is also an abundance of bars. And at the bars, as well as on the street, during the day and at night, the women are those who control what goes on in the city. They control the production and sale of khat, a plant that is a stimulant that marks the rhythm of life in Harar. According to local journalists, the first women's association in Ethiopia was established in Harar. Today, there are more than 50 professional women's associations in Harar, which have created a mutual help network around which economic, political, and social activities revolve. For centuries, Harar was the key point for trade between Ethiopia and the Somali coast. To safeguard its sanctity and commercial supremacy, Harar was closed to the unfaithful until 1854, when Richard Burton succeeded in entering the walled city of Harar, where he remained for 10 years as a guest of the Sultan. There existed a curse which said that the power of the city would begin to decline upon the arrival of the first Westerner. Coincidence or not, from that moment on, a slow decline began, a decline which has kept the city dozing, drugged by the effects of khat. At the same time, Harar is a devoted, ancient, and sensuous city. This is the ambiance that Arthur Rimbaud searched for. The French poet took refuge here in Harar when he decided to abandon literature to become a trader and explorer. It was the perfect place to immerse himself completely in the myths of the East. Rimbaud was a genius who said everything he had to say before the age of 20. Then he abandoned poetry and the literary life of Paris to embark upon an African adventure. He was disillusioned with the world and with himself, with the vulgarity that surrounded him in Europe at that time. His rejection became an escape, a contradiction. He was a rebel who wanted to battle despair with the search for the extreme. In November of 1880, Rimbaud left Aden and crossed the Red Sea to Zeila, traveled the road through the Somali desert for 20 days, and entered Harar in order to take over the trade office of Aden. He arrived with the hope of striking it rich in a very short time. He lived in this house that is today a bar located in the heart of the city.
I have come to know the sky splitting with lightning, and the waterspouts and the breakers and current. I know the evening, and dawn rising up like a flock of doves. And sometimes I have seen what men have imagined they saw. I have seen the low-hanging sun speckled with mystic horrors, lighting up long violet coagulations like the performers in very antique dramas. Waves rolling back into the distances, their shiverings of Venetian blinds. I have dreamed of the green night, of the dazzled snows, the kiss rising slowly to the eyes of the seas, the circulation of undreamed of saps, and the yellow-blue awakenings of singing phosphorus.
Khat is a cultural stimulant. It's very unusual for someone to take it alone, since it is essentially a social drug. It gives one energy and improves one's memory, but it also produces depression, insomnia, and sexual impotence. It's taken with the family, at weddings, and at religious events, and at town council meetings.
Some people take it to work better, and others take it to study. And there are also people who take it on weekends when going out with their girlfriends, or while having a few drinks to stay awake. While cultivating khat, it must be well cared for during the first 6 months. The weeds growing around it should be cut, and the plant must be watered often. It is also good to fumigate them with smoke, which helps the plant grow good leaves.
The tree normally grows only between 1 and 2,000 meters above sea level, only where there is no frost and a sufficient supply of water. The mountains of Harar and its surroundings offer the best khat in the world. It's consumed in Somalia, Djibouti, and Yemen, and it is even exported to the United States and England, where it is legal to consume it. Several tons of khat leave these lands every day and are distributed throughout the world. It must get to its destination quickly, however, because in barely 3 days, the plant loses its narcotic properties and becomes useless. Khat does not have a specific growing period. It grows throughout the year, and these mountain highways to the airport or the local highways form part of the landscape of the Horn of Africa.
Khat has a long history. It has been consumed here for centuries. When there is a Muslim wedding, for example, everyone comes together to enjoy khat, and then they carry out all the other traditional rites. The Czechs, the religious leaders, also consume khat and then read the Quran. There are some who consume khat since they have nothing else to do. They just spend the day high on this plant. Women also like to enjoy khat. My friends and I get together at one of our homes once a week, and we talk while we eat khat.
The origin of khat is unknown, although it has been confirmed that there are plantations that have produced this plant for more than 500 years. As for the rest of the stories, they are only legends about its origin. The stories say that it is found in Yemen and even in Somalia, but khat has always come from Harar. Less khat was eaten in the past than today. Its use was exclusively intellectual or social, and idle people dedicated to the consumption of drugs didn't exist. Women have been responsible for maintaining the consumption of khat within traditional practices. It's very odd to see women affected by overconsumption.
But now I, a boat lost under the hair of coves, hurled by the hurricane into the birdless ether, I, whose wreck, dead, drunk, and sodden with water, neither monitor nor hand ships would have fished up. Who ran, speckled with lunula of electricity, a crazy plank with black seahorses for escort, when Julys were crushing with cudgel blows skies of ultramarine into burning funnels. I, who trembled to feel at 50 leagues distance the groans of behemoths rutting, and of the dense maelstroms, eternal spinner of blues immobilities, I long for Europe with its aged old parapets.
Christians have always considered khat to be a Muslim vice. One of the oldest references to khat in Ethiopia forms part of the threat by a 14th century Muslim king who wanted to plant khat in the capital of the Christian king. This is how the traveler Richard Burton described the sensations of silent contemplation that he enjoyed during these evenings of Eastern ecstasy. It is the satisfying delivery to the existence of animals, the passive pleasure of the mere senses, the pleasurable weakness, the dreamy tranquility, the building of castles in the air. In the East, man is satisfied with resting in the shade, happy alongside the bank of a sparkling river, or the freshness of the protection of a perfumed tree, smoking a pipe, or sipping a cup of coffee. But above all, by disturbing the mind and body the least amount possible. The problem being conversation, the dissatisfactions that memory can cause, and the vanity of thought, the most unpleasant interruptions. In this ancient palace in Harar, Haile Selassie, the last Ethiopian emperor, was born and lived. Haile Selassie was governor of Harar from a very young age. He grew from his privileged position as governor to become a contender to the throne after the death of Menelik II. After the assassination of the emperor in 1975 and the seizing of power by Mengistu's communists, the family of Haile Selassie was driven out of this home. At present, it's occupied by several families that have divided the space in a very non-aristocratic way. A naturist doctor, Saik Jadji, has his clinic on the bottom floor and claims that he cures cancer and diabetes, as well as other less serious illnesses like diarrhea or the evil eye.
God brings on these illnesses and takes them away when he wants. Many people have been cured with these medicines. For example, those who have swollen feet or swollen neck, and women with chest problems. Even the Ministry of Public Health has tried my medicines and accepts them. I have cured many people.
It does not cost Saik anything to rent this building. His consultations are free, and the local government has ceded the house to him in exchange for the services that he offers the community. To cure people, he uses medicinal plants that he himself collects in the mountains near Harar. He is one of the last heirs to a tradition of natural medicine that goes far beyond what historians are able to remember.
I have seen archipelagos of stars and islands whose delirious skies are open to sailors. Do you sleep? Are you exiled in those bottomless nights, million golden birds, O life force of the future? But truly, I have wept too much. The dawns are heartbreaking, every moon is atrocious, and every sun bitter. Sharp love has swollen me up with heady languors. Oh, let my keel split. Oh, let me sink to the bottom.
The women's associations are one of the most singular movements in the social life of Harar.
The Harari population has been associated with different organizations. Little girls are taught the Quran starting at a very early age. Then, when they are old enough, they form associations that are called low associations, which are second-level groups. From there, they move on to the highest level called a fortia. From this age on, they take care of themselves and are even responsible for their families. Although men have their own associations, in reality, women carry out most jobs of responsibility. In fact, if women are mistreated or discriminated against, it is resolved through the associations. There is a book that was written 500 years ago, which talks about how the women of Harar lived together. They were members of a group, and it can be said that this was the first women's association in the world. They have a president, secretary, and their own rules. According to the book, if one of them is mistreated or a member of the family dies, they all help each other. What I want to say is, the struggle of Harari women began a long time ago, and there were even some women that reigned on the throne. Most of the Harari population is Muslim. But here, Islam is conceived as the Prophet really wanted, including equality between men and women. The book more or less talks about these things among many others. Well, explaining it briefly, it more or less talks about the things that the women here in Harar have been doing for a long time.
Sophie emigrated to Djibouti a few years ago to work as a prostitute. She fell in love with a French soldier and bore his child. Shortly after the birth of the baby, the soldier abandoned her and she had to return home.
In order to survive, I established a small kiosk in my home, which is how I take care of my baby. I go to the market, I buy from the wholesalers, and then I resell the things here. I make a 5 to 10 cent profit. With this money, I can make a living for my child and myself. Well, I live this way and have never returned to Djibouti. He has not returned either. He told me that he was going to take me with him, but I never heard from him again. He once sent me a letter, but I burned it. My son always asks about his father. Every time he sees a white man, he asks me, "Where is my father?" And he asks me if I gave birth without a father. It bothers me. But his father is in his country. Where am I going to find him? I tell him that he is in France and that someday he will come to get him. But since he does not understand, he's always crying. And when I see him cry, I also start to think of him, and I feel very bad. When he is older, I want him to know about his family. I want him to meet his father. My son is not easy. He has a strong character. He is not like a normal child here in Ethiopia. I have no family here. I'm alone. In other words, I have no one to help me. I'm trying to move on by myself. A fatherless child is very difficult. He's always thinking about him. And when he sees an airplane, he says his father's up there.
Deri Work sets up her small stall near the main gate of the old city. She has dedicated herself to writing love letters and poems for over 10 years. She writes them to order and charges 5 cents for them.
When I have time, I read a lot at home as well as here. I do not copy the poems from the books that I read, but I invent them myself. They are about love, about loving someone. I know what love is. There are 3 kinds of love. Love of another person, love of a family, and the love of God. I love God and people as well. I can write in different ways, with different styles. I have experience and I can do it. This is my gift, to write and to compose.
Calligraphy is one of the oldest arts in the city of Harar. A dying activity that has been kept alive by 6 old calligraphers. Arabic script was considered poor before the arrival of Islam. It was a handwriting that did not possess aesthetic value. With the appearance of the Quran, Muslims made an effort to beautify the writing until reaching a grade of excellence. Their aim was not only evocative, but symbolic. Through beauty comes inspiration, and inspiration is the first step on the path towards God. Harar, as the 4th holy city of Islam, was one of the places that consecrated the study of calligraphy. Its calligraphers were put to use in philosophy, medicine, and poetry.
Dear mother, I count on not staying here much longer. You will hear about my departure very soon. I have not found what I was searching for, and I am living in the most boring way and don't take advantage of my time. As soon as I have saved 500 or 2,000 francs, I will leave, and I will do so with the least regret.
When Richard Burton crossed this territory and entered Harar, the area was already depressed. Upon arrival, the Englishman described a desolate panorama. He stated that the men were insensitive and stubborn. He said the women were attractive, but never stopped screaming, and that the men, as well as the women, were famous for their moral decay. The Englishman broke the Victorian taboos about sexuality and spiked his travel stories with detailed descriptions about the erotic pleasures of Eastern men and women, about sensuality and the techniques of ecstasy. At that time, as today, desire walked around the Harar market with discretion, swathed in exchanged glances or protected by powerful steps which marked the territory. The women of Harar are the owners of space and willpower. Fatia, Sadiba, and Kadilla are three Oromo women who earn their living selling wood at the market. Every day, laden with wood, they walk the 10 kilometers that separate Harar from their town. Three 350 people make up the village. 80 of them are women over the age of 15. These 80 women carry on their backs the weight of the community's economy.
My name is Fatia Humar. My life begins very early in the morning. I make lunch, and then I go to the river for water. I make some tea, I breastfeed my baby, and I leave for the fields to work. I collect wood or work on the farm, depending on the time of the year. When I finish, I go to Harar. It takes me about 2 hours to get there. If I sell the wood, I buy food. If I don't, I carry the wood back home. When I get home, I make dinner and I go to sleep. The next day, I do the same thing. I do the same thing every day.
The men spend the day consuming khat and preparing the lands for sowing or harvesting. The division of work is very strict. Both men and women take care of the land, while only women take care of the rest. Both take care of the farm and the harvest, but the women are the ones who carry the surplus to the market to sell it. Sadiba is building a new home. She has recently married and finally is going to have a home for her and her family. Building a home is customarily a community event. All the people come to help with any task, however insignificant it may be.
When someone builds a home, everyone helps. Some cut wood, others go for water, and others do the cooking. It's like a great celebration. When the job is done, and if the food is ready, we eat. The rest of my life is the same as Fatia's. We do the same things, the exact same things.
The community is governed by a board made up of two men and two women who meet periodically. At the same time, the women have their own debate institution in which the 80 adult women participate. The democratic decisions and agreements made are taken to the board by the two women representatives.
If you say that you cannot attend, you can send a member of the family. However, if one of you is presented with a problem, do you think you could resolve it alone? I don't think so. That is why I tell you that it is very important to join together. Because if each of us were to do things on our own, we would never resolve the problems that we have.
I want to say something. What has made the problem worse is the lack of rain during these last 4 or 5 years. Some of us have to travel very far to find water, and others to find wood. And above all, if we have to attend the meeting, we do not have enough time to take care of our homes. And the children want to eat at night. And our husbands are off doing whatever it is they do. We have to prepare their food too. It is difficult for most of us to attend because of these reasons. If not, we would love to. Yes, but I did not say that you don't come because you don't want to.
I understand that if you don't come, it is because you have problems. What I say is that when we call you to come to the meeting, if we all come and we talk about our problems, we can solve them together.
The main source of income for these women is the sale of wood. They go to the mountains every day. They cut it and pile it up, and they carry it to the market according to their needs. It takes them about 2 hours to walk the distance between their town and Harar. If sales go well, they can earn up to 50 cents a day. If they go poorly, they have to return home with the load on their heads. The money is used to buy salt and other basic foods that they acquire at the market. Harar is not only a Muslim island in the center of a Christian ocean, but it is a kind of city, a cultural state, a universe of particular customs and ways. Harari is spoken in Harar, a language that is only used in this region. The old suspicion of foreigners and the dark desire to remain isolated from the world have relaxed over time. It does not aspire to political independence anymore. Today, in Harar, nationalism is expressed like a discreet pride for conserving what makes them different and identifies them, but nothing else. Weddings have always been one of the opportune moments to express this culture. In his stories, Burton wrote about how rich Harari men liked to marry very fat women, and that sometimes they had problems on their wedding night since they weren't able to locate the right spot. That's why there are so many cushions in the Harari home, because the cushion is used to raise the wife's buttocks to facilitate the husband's job. Both Burton and Rimbaud describe the hyenas of Harar in their writings. For centuries, the hyenas would come close to the walls of the city to eat the garbage at night. It was the custom of certain men to feed the hyenas. Yusuf Noume is the only one left. Every day, he collects the remains of the unusable meat and bones from the slaughterhouse. On rare occasions, he kills a cow or a lamb. When night falls, he calls the hyenas to eat. He knows them by name, and they come like trained dogs when they hear him call. Before, it was a custom. Today, it is a show that Yusuf repeats every night for the tourists who visit the city of Harar. With the daily sale of chat, Waleto earns $15 a week. Her real business is the trip that she takes to Djibouti to sell large amounts. To do so, she has to travel by truck to Diredawa, the new financial capital of the region. There, she must wait until the gates of the station are opened in order to take the train that travels only 3 days a week between Addis Abeba and Djibouti. The train is the economic engine of eastern Ethiopia. And the train was also the cause of the definitive decline of Harar. Its inauguration in 1917 marked the beginning of the end for the city. The train replaced the caravans, and the merchandise that would come and go from the Gulf of Aden stopped passing through Harar. The cars are mainly filled with people traveling to Djibouti for the same reasons as Waleto. From Ethiopia, and following different paths, 8 tons of chat are exported to Djibouti daily. The small traders travel by train, those traders who do this sporadically and sell a poor quality of chat. Most of the 8 tons of chat, which is primarily of high quality, travels by plane. Each one of these people needs to have a special license. 2 out of every 3 of them do not have one and sell smuggled merchandise. Saeed Mohamed travels by train 3 times every 15 days and has been making the same journey for 5 years. He takes 9 kilos of chat to Djibouti. On his way back, he smuggles clothes and electronic devices. Half of his earnings are used to bribe the customs officers. Sometimes they confiscate his merchandise anyway, and he loses everything. Asha Adi sells cabbage, onions, chili, potatoes, and chat. She has a license to sell everything except for the chat, which she hides among the vegetables. When the train makes a stop, the traders take advantage of the opportunity to sell part of their merchandise. Each kilometer that the train travels away from Diredawa, the price of chat is raised in the same proportion. In Harar, a kilo costs $1. In Djibouti, it costs $25. The construction of the railroad from Djibouti to Addis Abeba was marked by disaster since its beginnings in 1897. Menelik II wanted to modernize Ethiopia, and this train line was the symbol of modernity. The route to the Red Sea required the tracks to cross one of the most inhospitable territories on Earth. Each kilometer of the line required at least 70 tons of rails and enormous amounts of cement and water, which had to be brought in from considerably far distances. If the workers survived the heat, it was quite probable that they would die shot to death by armed band members of the Issa tribe, who were fiercely against the project. The court of Negus, kings and ambassadors, artists, architects, and adventurers have traveled on this train hoping to reach the imperial city, the capital of the last African empire. But today, it bears smugglers and traders like Waleto. It lacks aristocratic glamour. Nothing remains of its ancient splendor except the scorching heat of the rails and the slow beat of the rhythm of the crickets. Rimbaud never saw the train. He only made two trips to Harar, both on camelback. His last trip was made on a litter when he was sick with syphilis. He abandoned Africa without fulfilling his desires, the dreams he had when he had left Europe behind years before.
Perhaps the day will arrive when I can peacefully drink in some old city where I will die much happier. I am patient and know how to wait. If my evil resigns itself, if one day I have gold, will I go north or to the country of vineyards? Ah, dreaming is shameful. It's pure loss. If I become the traveler who I once was, let no inviting inn open its doors to me. Now I am accursed. The motherland appalls me, while the best thing is to sleep drunk on the sand.